workshop is an overview of the whole early years curriculum. There'll be other workshops throughout the year that go into more detail about phonics, so there'll be a phonics workshop and we'll go into a bit more detail about phonics. There'll be a reading workshop, a writing workshop, so I do recommend that you go to those. The idea of the workshop today is for you to have an idea of what a day looks like in the reception classroom, things that your children will be learning, and to sort of realise what's expected of them by the end of the year. The handout that I've given to you is the early learning goals. At the end of the year, this is what we look at to assess the children. So don't read it and panic now, because this is for the end of the year. So we look at these, and at the end of the year, you'll get a report for your child. If they've met all of the early learning goals, it will say that they are expected. So and we'll do it for each individual early learning goal. If they've worked beyond that, it will say exceeded. And if they haven't met the early learning goals, so they're working at an earlier stage in the curriculum, it will say emerging. Or if they're starting to do some of these things but haven't met all of the criteria, it will say emerging. Your teachers will talk to you about that throughout the year. You will know through your meetings with teachers whether your child is on track to be expected, emerging or exceeded. Those types of conversations we've had at parent meetings when you see your teacher. So don't panic. You will be kept up to date all the time. You should know, as the year's progressing, how your children are getting on. So, I'm going to start with the aims of the session. So I want you to understand the structure of the early years curriculum, because there is quite a lot to it in the session. We've got quite a lot to cover. Also, obviously, helping you understand those expectations, where children need to be by the end of the year. And also, we've just sort of put together some ways that you can support your children at home. It's not as scary as homework, but there are just things that can help you to support your child. So I'm going to start to go through that now. This is an overview of the early years curriculum. There are prime areas and specific areas. In the first term, we work a lot on the prime areas. We really focus on the prime areas. They're called prime areas because without the prime areas, it's really hard to teach the specific areas. If children haven't got good listening and attention, you know, if their attention spans are very long, they're not very good at listening, it's going to be really hard to teach them maths if they can't concentrate and attend to what you're saying. So the prime areas are the sort of foundations. We really focus on that this term. So you've got PSED, which is split into different aspects, physical development and communication and language. So a lot of what we do in the first term is based on those things. We do the other stuff as well, but we really focus on those prime areas. Specific areas are literacy, maths, understanding the world and expressive arts and design. I'm going to go through into a little bit more detail through each part now. Apart from just looking at those areas, in reception, your report at the end of the year will also tell you about the characteristics of effective learning. Because it's our job in reception to make children enjoy learning, you know, love learning, have a good attitude to learning. And that is what the characteristics of effective learning are about. We're trying to develop children to keep trying, to have resilience and, you know, we don't give up. That's one of our mottos in school. Yes, those are the characteristics of effective learning. We think about their confidence as well, and also curiosity. We want them to want to learn about things and to find out more. So really, reception is about developing that love of learning as well. And your child's end of year report should really reflect how they progress through the characteristics of effective learning. These are the things that we look at, the characteristics of effective learning, and these are the types of things that we're aiming for, that children find new ways to do things. But if they're starting something and it's not working out, if they're making something, and the way they're doing it, you know, instead of getting frustrated and giving up and walking away, that they'll try something else and they won't give up. Thinking of different ideas, and also sort of analysing if things worked or didn't and why, and using that when they work in the future. There's active learning, and that's about paying attention and being involved in learning, being excited to learn, and sort of accepting challenges as well, that they want to challenge. Because I think sometimes we sort of jumping to help children, because we can see them getting frustrated, but it's about them learning to channel that frustration and to keep going, rather than for us to jump in and do it for them because they're getting a bit frustrated. And there's the playing and exploring. We do lots of that. A lot of our learning is through play in reception. It starts off, obviously, particularly in the first term, there will be a lot of play-based learning. So you might ask them what they've been doing at school, and they might say, oh, I just played all day. But they will be learning, I promise you. And ways that you can develop these skills at home, some suggestions, are allowing children to have a go at things and give it a try, and not worrying if they don't get it right first time or if they're struggling with it. And it's avoiding that jumping into help. It's things like we try to, when they're struggling to drop their coat, we might help them, but we always say to them, we try to teach them how to do it. We say, you try first, and then if they still struggle, we help them. And it's just about supporting that at home as well, and giving them that bit of independence to give things a try. Embracing questions. I know it can be very annoying, lots of questions all the time. But that's how they're showing their enthusiasm to learn new things. They want to know more. So as difficult as it is, try to embrace those questions. Praising effort and not achievement. That's a really big one. So like when they are, you know, it doesn't matter about the finished product. We say things like, oh, I like the way you kept going and you didn't give up, rather than just, oh, that's a lovely picture. That's sort of praising the outcome rather than the effort. So we try to do that at school, and that's something that will help them at home as well, really praising them when they've tried hard and they've kept going, rather than just the finished product of, oh, that's a lovely picture, or, oh, that's really clever, well done. That sort of cuts it to a stop, and rather than praising them, tried hard and they've kept going. And encourage them to have a go and take a risk. We do that through things like forest schools, trying to get them out and about, and we encourage them to try and have a go at new things. They're doing that a lot at the moment because everything's new to them at school, but some of them are a little bit reluctant at first, and it's encouraging them, even though they haven't had a go at it before, to have a go and try something new. So that's the characteristics of effective learning. I'm going to go on to the specific areas now in the curriculum. The first one is communication and language. And I've put this first because this is, I would say, the main building block to everything else. If children struggle with communication and language, that does have a massive impact on every single other area of the curriculum. So communication and language is so important. The strands that we look at are their listening and attention, their understanding, and their speaking. The way that we support that, come in. No, you'll be fine. Come in. If you sign in for me, and then take a seat. The way we support that in school, we have a weekly, I don't know if anyone's heard of Philosophy for Children, that's what PFC stands for. We think of like a big question that we put out there to children, or they can think, and then eventually they start to think of big questions. There are things we talk about, like if things like, when things are, you know, Jack and the Beanstalk, we'll look at the story, and Jack steals in that story, and we'll talk about whether, you know, was it okay for him to steal because he's poor? You know, that we look at, we think a stimulus might be a story, might be a picture, and then they have a think about, sort of, and discussion about a topic that we're looking at. So that's Philosophy for Children. And circle time. So we probably start off with circle time and build up to philosophy. They're doing lots of circle times at the moment about making friends, playing with, you know, how to join with playing with new people, following the rules, lots of those circle times are happening at the moment. And all of these things get to take turns, to listen to other people, to show their understanding. We do something called story scribing as well. I don't know if anyone's heard of that before. And this is to encourage language. So they can't write stories yet, but they've got so many good ideas. We allow them to tell us a story, and we write it down for them. As the time goes on, that develops. So we might say to them, oh, you have a go at that word. Once they start to learn phonics, they might be able to have a go at a word like fox or something like that. So we'll say to them, oh, you could have a go at that word or that sound. And they have a little go. But they can tell us the story, and we scribe it for them. And that really encourages their language. So, yeah, story scribing helps their descriptive language as well, sort of develops their communication skills. We've all got role play corners in the classrooms. They're home corners at the moment. So that's for the place that's most familiar to them, but we do develop that as the year goes on. And small world play and little toys. We sometimes link the story scribing to that. They're telling the story with the people, and we'll go and sort of write down their story for them. So that's the sort of things we do to support communication and language in school. Chatterboxes is on there, that would be the half-term homework. We'll ask you, don't worry about it yet, you've got a while, but we'll ask you to make a box, a shoe box, and fill it with things that are important to your child or things that they can talk about, and then they'll bring it into school and they share it with their friends and they talk about it. Children find it much easier to talk about the things they know, their favourite things, the things they love, so Chatterbox is a great way for us to develop not only our knowledge of the children but their communication skills. So Chatterbox is something we'll be doing at school as well. How to support your child at home. From this Friday, you have a big talk homework. Just spending that time speaking to children, listening to them, but also giving them the opportunity to listen to you as well, really helps. So big talk homework, we do that once a week. So big talk homework's really useful. Modelling as well. Modelling, speaking in full sentences. If children are not doing that, repeating things back to them. Modelling use of language, those sorts of things will help at home. Stories, this is why we send home our sharing books as well. Reading and sharing stories is a really good way to develop communication and language. Children will develop their vocabulary through reading lots of stories and books. Playing instruction games as well. This develops a listening attention, Simon says, and then repeating the instructions. That will help with listening and attention. And if you do have concerns about your child's speech or their communication, it's really important to let the teacher know that you've got those concerns, because the quicker we can get something put in place to support your child, the quicker it will help them to develop in all areas of the curriculum. Because communication and language is really important. So if you do have any concerns, do make sure you speak to your child's class teacher about it. Okay. PSED is next, which is personal, social and emotional development. The strands to PSED are making relationships, we're doing lots of that at the moment, building friendships, relationships with the teachers, managing feelings and behaviour, and self-confidence and self-awareness. You can see why we start with these areas of learning first. The way we support children in school, we've got lots of lovely PSED stories about starting school, making friends, what happens when things go wrong. We've got lots of really good PSED stories in school. Circle time helps with PSED as well. Role play activities. Sometimes teachers going in and doing a bit of role play with the children, sort of models to them how to ask to play. So we'll do things like we'll say to children, oh, can I play? So that it, joining their role play game, so that it models to them what they can do to help them building relationships. We've got lots of games and activities and discussion during activity time. This is where activity time is what we call the time where they're allowed to go and play and learn through play. And the teachers get really involved with that. Like you'll see the teachers sort of getting in and playing with the children, and through discussing things with them and teaching them, that really helps them to make relationships, to build friendships, to learn about sharing. We get really involved in their activity time and their play. And ways to support your child at home are playing games where they have to take turns, wait for a turn, discussion again at home, promoting friendships as well. Having people around for tea or going to the park with some children after school, that will really help your child to build friendships and relationships in school. And modelling, compromise and turn-taking, that one person wants to do one thing, one person wants to do another. Sometimes we model, first we'll do a bit of what you want to do, then we'll play my game. We do lots of that in school as well, but modelling that at home for the children will really support them as well. Next we've got physical development. The strands of physical development are moving and handling and health and self-care. So you've got moving and handling is things like their gross motor skills and coordination, as well as writing and fine motor skills. And the health and self-care side of things is toileting, being healthy, eating healthy foods, that sort of thing. And the way we support that at school is children can access during activity time. That develops, there are things like the mountain, we've got building blocks that are quite big, you know, that develops their gross motor skills. On a Friday afternoon, every week, it will start this week, we have a physical development afternoon on the playground. Children go out to the playground, we've got bikes and scooters where they have to go around obstacles and things like that. Friday afternoon. They don't get changed for this, this is something we do first term every Friday afternoon. We have things like parachutes, we have throwing and catching games, so there's all sorts of different things set out for them, designed to help with their physical development, balancing, we do some balancing games. So yeah, there's lots going on the big playground on a Friday afternoon. We do right dance, every class will do right dance on a different day. They don't eat pea kits, they just take off their shoes and socks. And right dance is about linking large scale movements to making marks on a page. So I can give you an example. One of the lessons is about being a robot, so they do lots of jagged actions to music about being a robot. Then they get a really big sheet of paper, they've each got one. We play the music again and they sort of draw their movements on the paper and it helps them to develop, to move the large scale movements into sort of smaller scale movements to help with their writing. Developing their gross and fine motor skills really helps with their writing, so that's the first step. So once a week your child will have write dance. There'll be lots of videos and things on the Facebook group of write dance, they do really like that. We do a funky fingers session every day, which is a writing session, but at the moment we're really focusing on building up fine motor skills, so we do things like, we have tweezers, and they have to move things with tweezers, they play games, so they do as many as they can in a minute. We've got something called Dojin that one of the OSA's runs, where they play Doh to music, and they get all of their fingers, and they exercise their fingers, so that they're developing their dexterity for writing in their fingers, and once a week, doing funky fingers, they'll work with their teacher to do some writing in their writing book. So there are lots of great activities that go on. We change it up all the time, tracing, threading, and eventually, towards the end of the year, they'll be writing. We've got Play-Doh and tools out most of the time as well to develop that dexterity. Creative area with tools like scissors to use. There's a fine motor zone where we need some of those things like the tweezers, the threading, tracing, we leave those out during activity time so that they can do that during activity time. And the circle time section is later on in the year, we move on to have circle time about being healthy, eating healthy foods, exercising, and that's just to develop their understanding for that part of it. Yes? They do activate humour. They do activate first thing in the morning after the register and in the afternoon. That develops their concentration as well as being a physical thing. It's sort of to develop the length of their concentration as the year goes on, that they've got to concentrate and copy what the lady's doing. Pardon? It's a programme designed by Val Sabin. I don't know if anyone's heard of Val Sabin before. Val Sabin writes programmes for like gymnastics, and games and dance, and it's like a company that's been created, and they created something where you move to music, so children will do different actions to music, and yeah, they're sort of like mini dances really, but it's physical development, but it also helps with their listening, attention and concentration, and they do that every day. Okay, and how to support your child at home is just to get active. Go to the park and use play equipment, riding bikes, being creative as well, because the fine motor skills are really helped by things like colouring, drawing, tracing, Play-Doh, and also cooking and talking about dinners and whether they're healthy or not. That helps with all that side of things as well. We have a mixture. We're hoping to get some more balanced bags this year. We sort of develop that as the term goes on. So we start off with scooters and tricycles, and then as it goes on, we move on to balanced bikes and squat. We've got a couple of two more bikes as well. So that's physical development. Now we're going on to the specific areas. Literacy. We do start literacy and maths alongside the primary areas now. The two strands of literacy are reading and writing. And the ways that we support children in school, we do lots of big books and shared stories. I'm sure your children have told you they've had a story every day at school so far. We have a daily chronic session. They'll start on Monday. So the first step to that is them just learning the sounds, so that when they see the letter S, it makes a sound. That's the first stage, and then they'll go on to start to use those sounds to read. So they'll have daily chronic sessions starting from Monday. We have a word for the day as well, starting from Monday, to help with their readings. There are some words that we call tricky words that they can't sound out, they just have to learn to read it. An example is the word I. Where we ask the children lots of questions. So it's not just about them listening to the story or when they can read about reading a story. It's about them showing their understanding by answering questions about the story. And it, things like their opinions as well. What do you think we should have done? What would you have done next? Those sorts of questions as well. So we do lots of questioning when we read our stories. Again, Funky Fingers and Dojin will help with their writing. Story scribing helps with their storytelling. We do name writing every day as well. We do it within Funky Fingers. So within a week, every week they'll work with an adult to help them to learn to write their name. I don't know if you know that we use cursive fonts in school. So the reason we do that is because eventually it does support them because they have to learn joined writing as they go up into year one and two. And also it does help them that it always starts and finishes on the line. At first you'll wonder why on earth we're teaching them cursive writing, because they do find it quite tricky at first. But by the end of the year, I think you'll really see the impact of it. A lot of children leave reception with really nice cursive writing. So bear with us, in the first term it is really difficult and they do find it quite hard. As it goes on, they do get it. So with the name writing, the teachers or LSAs that work with them really focus on their letter formation. And we try to make sure most children can write their name by Christmas. And we do some individual letter formation at school as well. So we have like small handwriting sessions. This is not yet, this is later in the year. After the Easter holidays, we'll start to do small handwriting sessions where we'll focus on a letter at a time to practice the formation. How to support your child at home? Looking for sounds and words around you. Sharing books to model your reading skills to children. Talking about the books that you've read, so that they're understanding and comprehension. Children creating their own stories from picture books is really important. Tomorrow, all of your children will bring home a reading book. We've been assessing the children. Some children can read some words already, but everybody starts on a library book because that develops communication and language as well as their literacy skills, because they have to think of a story, use their imagination and think of a story. So all children will come home with a lilac book tomorrow. They'll have no words in them, but they're for the children to read to you and to make up a story and read with you. Those are the level of reading books. It's not just lilac. Once children start to learn their phonic sounds and they start to learn their phase words, the levels of the books will go up. Children by the end of reception are expected to be on yellow phase words, you'll get a zippy wallet with phonic, one with phonics and one with phase words. You can chop them up to make flashcards so that you can play different games. I will send home lots of information about that when I send home the homework, so don't worry too much about it. There'll be lots of ideas. Fine motor activities will help with writing, things like tracing, colouring in. Story scribing, you're more than welcome to give that a go at home. If they're telling you stories, scribing them and writing them down for the children will really help them to see their stories come to life, so they've got that bit of confidence when they come to it later. And also, we will be sending home at Christmas time for you the individual letter formation. This year, we're going to ask, because lots of children like to write Christmas cards, so at about the start writing their Christmas cards. They're going to send home the letters. So when they're practicing writing their name on their Christmas card, you can help them with their formation. Okay, mathematics. We've got a slightly different way of teaching mathematics. Well, I say different. Lots of schools in the country are teaching mathematics. So it's in Singapore. I don't know if anybody's heard of that before. I'll go into a bit more about that. In school, every day, children have a 10 to 15 minute math session. Again, this is starting on Monday. This week we're still settling the children in. They'll have a 10 to 15 minute mathematics session, followed by a maths meeting. Maths meetings are really short, they're about 5 minutes, and we do a song or a game or something that will recap what we've already learned so that they're, you know, we don't want to sort of do days of the week once in a year and never do it again. It's things that we can keep coming back to. So we'll sing a days of the week song, a counting song, and we'll sort of go over things through maths meetings. They have access to maths resources during activity time. There's a maths area. We encourage counting and the use of mathematical vocabulary through play. We also like to do things like cooking in school to sort of develop that sort of like you know, weighing and measuring language as well. And we sing lots and lots of number songs. I'm sure we'll be annoyed with them by the end of the year. We sing loads of number songs. And we've got a series of songs called Number Fun, which the children really love. And they'll learn lots and lots of number songs. I'm going to go back now to talking about Singapore Maths so that you've got a bit of an understanding about the way that we teach maths. During a mathematics session, all children will have the same focus. So an example is, hello, he's signing for me and so the focus might be numbers to five, one to five, and all children will have the same focus. The first thing we'll do is focus on it in a concrete way, so we'll have objects. So we'll have five objects and we'll do counting, matching numbers with objects to five. Then we go on to visual, so it might be something on the board that's 1 to 5 for us to match numbers and count with visual things on the board, or pictures, little pictures. And then we go on to abstract. This is where we might do things like 3 add 2 is 5. So even though we're doing 5, that's a really abstract concept for children to understand. And children will be working at different stages. You know, depending on what they already know. So we start with the concrete, move on to visual, and then it's abstract. Some children will then go on to mastery. If they've grasped the concept that 3 add 2 is 5, we'll then start to do some problem solving with them. We might look at 5P, different ways of making 5P, or we might look at a problem where it says, can you find every single way that you can make 5 using these cubes? So they find lots of different ways. So that's sort of how we work through it. So if, you know, we say that we're working from numbers 1 to 5, and you think your child already knows numbers 1 to 5, don't be alarmed, because we do work through these sort of stages. That's how we work at school. We always start with the concrete, and every lesson we always start with practical objects, and then children will progress into different stages from there. How to support your child at home. Number recognition is really important, so recognising numbers in the environment. And I would say up to 20, that our magic number at reception, they need to be able to do everything with numbers of 20. Addition, subtraction, recognition, one more, one less, all with numbers to 20. So try not to go too far ahead. Don't worry if they're not recognising numbers beyond that at the moment. Really focus. And as I say, we need to be able to do everything with those numbers as well. So lots of counting. And when we say counting, lots of children are great when they start from 1 and they go all the way through to 20. But we do things like start at 14. What comes after 14? Let's count to 20 from 14 so that they know which number comes next, which can be quite tricky. And we do that with like dice games. So we'll roll the dice and count from the number that it lands on, things like that. So lots of counting. You're just using the language really, or who's got more, how many less. Lots of children know the word more, less is the one that they tend to find to important. Shapes as well, just shape names. lens, looking for shapes in the environment, playing with shapes, and mathematical language to do with time, money, and measure, and just using them in everyday life. You probably do it all the time without realising it, but talking to your children when you go to the shops about how much things cost, if you're going to get change, it's just developing the language in reception for those things. They don't need to be able to know how much the change is going to be, but it's just developing that language so they understand what that means. Okay. Understanding the world. The strands of understanding the world are people and communities, the world and technology. The things that we do in school, every week from Christmas, we start to introduce an understanding the world session. So there'll be different things that we talk about. It'll have different focuses each time. And that is included in certain times again. We use that in class for understanding the world. Stories again. We try to use stories from different cultures to give children an understanding. The main thing in reception for children to understand, you'll see if you've got one of the handouts and you look at what the children need to know to understand the world, it's a lot about understanding similarities and differences. So we use stories from different cultures to talk about things that are different, things that are similar. Then we celebrate different festivals through the year. So we have lots of special days. When it's Diwali, we'll talk to the children about that. Christmas, Hanukkah, Chinese New Year. So it's for them to start to realise that people celebrate different things and to understand what those celebrations are all about. So we do lots of special days in reception to celebrate those different festivals. ICT, we have lots within the classroom. We've got iPads in class. They're not out all the time because otherwise sometimes it'd be hard to drag the iPads away from them. We try to do it one session in the morning or afternoon. And we try to change it up so it's not always iPads. Sometimes there are laptops out. We've got things like ICT toys in the role play corners, tills and things like that. That all counts as ICT as well. We have got B-bots that we sometimes get out as well. They're like little floor robots and they have to program them to go in different directions. They look like little bees, they're very cute. After Christmas, we'll start taking children. We've got an ICT suite upstairs. We'll start to take children to the ICT suite. But first, we need to develop their physical development. Using a mouse and clicking, children find really hard until they've developed their dexterity in their hands. Like double clicking and dragging things, it's really difficult for them at first. And that is a lot of what we work on at first up in the ICT suite. We evolve our topics based on children's interests as well. We talk a lot about, you know, what children enjoy, different topics that children like. An example of that is we had a topic last year on fairies and elves, and children absolutely loved that. But then one day, someone came in and they brought some Pokemon cards in, and other children had never seen them before. So we had a whole day about Pokemon just because, you know, in reception we've got that luxury of really being able to play with their interests. I went and got some pictures from the computer of Pokemon, and they were making their own Pokemon cards, children were making Pokeballs, like, it was, you know, they loved it. So we've got that luxury in reception that we can really talk about children's different interests and spend time, you know, getting them to love school and love their learning through those different topics. So we do a lot of that in school as well. And we like trips to local places. Our first trip in reception, you'll find out more about it in my topic letter, but we're going to be doing a magic topic, and they're going to make magic potions. So we're going to go to the park and collect some things for our magic potions, and then come back and we're all going to make a big magic potion. So that will be our first visit. You'll find out exactly when that is because we'll need care and helpers, so we'll be asking you to come along. But we like lots of local visits. We like going to the shops so that they understand, you know, that's where we go to use money, and we, you know, we enjoy doing lots of different things in the local community. Children will get a chance, everyone, to do forest schools. I'll be taking children to forest schools on a Tuesday afternoon. We do have to take turns, both of them only take half a class at a time. I think we're starting with Scotland next week. You'll get your letter on Friday. So some of class Scotland will be going to forest schools next week, but everyone does get turns. And we have lots of visitors. We're really excited because we're starting to get the visitors in. Last year, our favourite, and this person came, we had somebody with a police dog come in. to teach us about what the police dog does in the community. So we've got a police lady that's offered to bring the police car and have a little chat with them about what she does. So there'll be loads of visitors, especially this term, coming in and teaching the children about the world around them and their community and different people in the community. And how to support your children at home is just chatting to them really, talking about family members, who is who in your family, what it was like when you were little, things that you like that are different from the things that they like. Days out are always really good for understanding the world. And looking, even on your walk home, looking at how things changed, because patterns and change is another thing that comes up a lot in the early years curriculum. And that's just things like them noticing that the leaves are starting to fall off the trees, or that in spring the blossom's starting to grow. So just pointing out those different things and how things are changing around them in the world, that really helps with understanding the world. And technology as well, like discussions about technology at home, things that other people might have. I know now a lot of people used to have desktops, whereas a lot of people now have iPads. So it's quite nice to sort of talk to children about different types of technology that they might see. And the last one, sorry, I feel like I've gone on. And the last one is creative development. The strands to creative development are exploring and using media and materials, and being imaginative. The ways that we support children in school are they've got access to creative area all the time. We fill it up with loads of different stuff. There's like baubles and feathers, and there's all sorts. Sometimes there's junk modelling and stuff in there. So they get access, and it's free reign. They find it quite difficult when they go to year one and they're not allowed to just go and pull everything out of there. But at the moment, they're allowed to just go in and take what they'd like. They can just create anything they like with those things. So it's nice for them to be imaginative, but it also has got different tools for them to use as well. Every classroom has a role play corner. Every room, like both sides, have got a small world area. So that's the area with a little house for them to sort of talk about the people and make up stories. Dressing up as well. We try to have sort of lots of different, like we've got policemen, firemen, so that they can start to think about different people in the community, dressing up as different people. And there's also, from January, a creative development session every week where we teach them a skill. The first thing that we tend to teach them in creative development is using the right colour, no green dots and things like that. We teach them different skills, whether it's painting, cutting, and we try to develop different skills in creative development. And ways that you can support your children at home are encouraging pretending games. I know some people at the coffee morning were talking about children really liking to be dogs really imaginative games at home, and it's encouraging those games at home to develop their imaginations. Listening to music and dancing, that's part of expressive arts and design. Drawing, colouring, painting, play-doh, all those messy things at home. So those sorts of things will really help your child to get creative training. The next thing I'm going to talk to you about, I've given you an overview of the curriculum, and as I say, there'll be other workshops that go more in detail to specific areas. So there will be a reading workshop for you to come and learn exactly how we teach reading. There'll be a phonics workshop so that you can go through exactly how we teach phonics. We just wanted to give you an idea of all the things that your children will be learning in reception. I want to talk about a good level of development. At the end of the year, we will say whether children have reached a good level of development or if they haven't. And to get a good level of development, children need to have achieved the early learning goals, which hopefully everybody's got a copy of, in the prime areas and maths and literacy. They don't have creative development or understanding the world, I'm not sure why, but if your child achieves expected levels in all of those areas, then they have achieved a good level of development. And that's at school, that's what we're aiming for the children. Tapestry, I was talking about. Has everybody had their email about tapestry? If you haven't signed up to tapestry yet, to do that, there are loads of lovely things that we put on there about your children, and they should start coming in, hopefully, to you very soon. We're also going to be starting some tapestry afternoons, where we invite you in with, and you can see your children and look at their tapestry with them, and hopefully make some comments on things that they've done, your own to their tapestry manager. We do a lot your child does something at home and you think, oh, they've never done that before, or they've never spoken about that before, it would be really great for you to add that, because it's all part, sometimes they're more confident at home, and you see things that we don't always see. So it's really lovely, we love seeing things that you share from your tapestry in their learning journey. So if you've got it, please do share things with us. Coffee mornings. We had our first coffee morning this morning, and it was Mrs. Godby and I, and we had a lovely time. I just wanted to remind you of them, and to say that you don't just have to come to the one with your child's teacher. They are available for you to come to any of them. So if you can't make the one that your child's teacher is at, do feel free to come to any of them. It's just nice for parents to get to know each other. It was really nice and relaxed this morning. We've tried to make it really informal. It just gives you a chance to get to know some people at school. But also, I'm always there, and there's a different teacher each time, so you can ask questions if you want to know how children are doing, how they're getting on, the types of things that they're doing in school. It's a really good opportunity to come and have a chat with that. So I really recommend that. It's great to see lots of faces at the next one, which is Friday, and it's Miss Webber. It takes a while to come through as well. So when we have our trip in spring term, we tend to be struggling to get DVS clearance. So if helping out regularly or helping on school trips is something that you think you'd be interested in, if you speak to your child's class teacher, they'll get a pat from Mrs. Lang for you, and we'll sign you up to have your DVS. As I said, we don't have parent helpers for the section until after Christmas.